that I would give you silver or gold, or that you would never feel the fire shiver in the cold. But I did say you'd never walk through this world alone. And I did say, don't make this world your own. I never said that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or that loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say I'd be right there by your side. And I did say I'll always help you find.
But you know I made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in every time of need. My love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you.
I never said that friends would never turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise. I didn't say you'd never taste the bitter kiss of death, or have to walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I did say I'd be waiting right on the other side. And I did say, I'll dry every tear you cry.
But you know I made a promise that I'd prepare a place, that someday sooner than you think, you'll see me face to face. And you'll sing with the angels and a countless multitude. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. So just keep on walking. Don't turn to the left or right, and in the midst of darkness, let this be your light. That hell can separate us, and you're gonna make it through. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. Oh, this is the promise. This is the promise I made to you.
That's the longest ending.
You know, there's some great promises in this Bible, and one of the greatest is that eternal life. Man's been seeking that. I seen a thing on one of the shows, I was flipping the channels talking about living forever, how science and stuff, coming up with new technology. I want to tell you something. The only people that has eternal life today is those that have trusted Christ as their Savior. You have it. Not going to get it. Have it. Isn't that something? That God Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, no wonder David said, "What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him?" Well, how would I look at my life and I'd say, "What in the world, God, would you even consider me to even have a thought toward me? What have I done? What have I done in my life that would make God smile at me and say, I'm pleased with old Brian?" Nothing. Except for the fact that I'm in his son. You know, folks, salvation is not about religion. It's not about joining the church. It's not about keeping the golden rule. It's not about being good. Salvation is about him. It's about the Lord Jesus Christ and what he's done for you. And that's the truth of the gospel. I want you to turn to Colossians chapter 1, and I'm not going to hold you too long. 50 minutes, so. No, just kidding. I probably ain't, but anyway. I notice this thing, what Paul says in Colossians chapter 1. I'm just going to begin in verse 3. "We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints." Paul heard of their faith. He didn't actually know them. And by the way, before I forget it, be accused going home with June, because she'll say, "You never mentioned it." Happy Mother's Day to you mothers. I hope you have a good and glorious day. Amen. So, in verse 5, he said, "For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the truth, in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto all the world as it is in all the world, as it come unto you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit." He's talking about the gospel now. "As it doeth also in you, since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth." Now there's some things about the truth, the gospel, that he brings out here. Number one, there's a hope that's concerning the gospel. Number two, he talks about that it brings forth fruit, the gospel does. And he also talks about, "and knew the grace of God in truth." So I want to talk to you about the truth of the gospel. And number one, the gospel is by grace. This is something that Christ wasn't forced to do. He said, "No man taketh my life, but I lay it down. I have the power to lay it down. I have the power to raise it up." Jesus Christ, a good type of that, is in the Old Testament when Abraham is going up on the mount. And he's going to offer, God tells Abraham, said, "Abraham, take Isaac, thy only son, and offer him upon an offering." And Abraham takes Isaac, gets some wood, takes the fire, and said, we're going up on the mountain. We're going to offer a sacrifice to the Lord. Now, you got to remember something about Isaac. Isaac was not no little boy. At that time, Isaac was a young man. And he goes up on that mountain. He says to Abraham, he said, I see the fire. I see the wood. But where is the sacrifice? Where's the lamb? And Abraham says, God will provide himself a lamb. So he takes him up there and he builds an altar. I see this in my mind. And he places the fire, he places the wood, and gets Isaac and puts him on that altar. Do you know Isaac was willing? Abraham's a type of God the Father. Isaac's a type of the Lord Jesus Christ there. And there Isaac gets on that altar. And Abraham pulls back that knife. And he's going to kill his son. Now, you got to think about it. God told Abraham, in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. And Abraham said, well, I have Ishmael. He's my seed. And God said, nope, that's not the one. You're going to have one. He's 100 years old. Sarah's 90 years old. And the Lord tells him, said, this time next year, Sarah's going to conceive and have a son. She's 90 years old. You ever heard of a 90-year-old woman having a baby? Now, come on, have you? Now think about what these people are doing. Abraham's 100 years old. And so Isaac is born, and there God tells him to put him on the altar. Kill him. Slay him. And Abraham goes up there. Do you know why Abraham did what he... Turn with me. Hang on to Colossians and turn over to Hebrews. And look at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Do you know, look what he talks about. This man, Abraham. Notice in verse 17. Hebrews 11, verse 17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Now here's the faith of Abraham. Verse 19. Accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in like figure. In other words, Abraham was dead, so to speak, and Isaac come forth from dead parents, so to speak, and there he is, and Abraham, his faith, I can put him to death, and I'm sure he told Isaac that, I'm going to slay you, but God Almighty that brought you into this world will raise you up from the dead. And Abraham believed God, and Isaac believed the Father. Jesus Christ was promised eternal life before the world began, and he believed the Father. Look in Titus. In Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1. Notice in Titus chapter 1. He says in verse 1, Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging of the truth, which is after godliness. Now watch it. In hope of eternal life, which God, the Father, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. Well, before the world began, who was back there for him to promise it to? Well, Jesus Christ. And no doubt Abraham talked to Isaac and said, this is the only way that we can handle this. And he builds the altar, and Isaac is willing to lay his life down because his father said that God would raise him up, and his father never lied to Isaac. And there he is, and in Abraham's mind, he's done slayed him. That's what he said in Hebrews. He counted it. And all of a sudden, the angel of the Lord said, Abraham, Abraham, here I am. Slay not thy son, thy only son. The point I want you to know is, that's grace. The grace of God, the unmerited favor of God, offered a sacrifice for everybody in this building. And the Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be offered. And God the Father promised him eternal life. And not only him, but those that put their faith in him. That's the truth of the gospel. The word gospel means good news. Well, I got some good news to tell you. You can have eternal life today. If you're not saved, you can have eternal life. If you are saved, then you ought to appreciate your eternal life and have faith and have assurance that God, that cannot lie, has promised you. Sung the song about great promises. Folks, God can't lie about this thing. If he lies about it, then he's destroyed himself. And if he destroys himself, there ain't no hope for none of us. And we might as well all go home and forget it. But he cannot lie. And he said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Believe what? Believe that he went to a cross. And on that cross, there he hung. There he hung for you. And they nailed him there. And there he is, beat where he was unrecognizable. No beauty about him that we would desire to be around him. We would turn our heads because of the horror that he went through. You can't imagine what Jesus Christ suffered for you that's in this room. You cannot get a grip on it. It's unthinkable. They talk about how they plowed his back in furs, how that they tore hunks of meat out of his back with a cat of nine tails, a whip, and he would whip the Lord, and he tied him to a post, and there he suffered, and there he bled. They pulled his beard out. They took a crown of thorns and smashed it down on his head, and they spit in his face, and they covered his face, and they took a reed, and they hit him in the head with it, and said, prophesy, who here smitest thou? And they took him out there in a stripped him down naked, no clothes whatsoever on him, and the soldiers ridiculed him and mocked him there in front of everybody. And there is the Son of God. There's the Creator of heaven and earth and His creation and His mankind. They're treating him like that, and he's going to a cross for the ones that was beating him. There he stood. And I can see in my mind's eyes when they take him out there to the cross, and there he is bearing that cross. And he's going down under the load, and they get a man, Rufus, to help him carry that cross. Weak, beaten, battered. I can see him when they take out them other crosses, and them men on that other crosses, and they lay them down, and you know they're probably spitting at the soldiers and cursing the soldiers, and there they're just despicable among thieves, and they're struggling. They don't want to be nailed to that cross, and they just fighting with every strength they got. And they come to the Lord, and he opens not his mouth. And he stretches that arm out there, and that hammer drives that spike, and the blood shooting up, spurting everywhere. Never says a word. They take his other arm, and there drives that spike in there, in his wrist, and there in his hands, and the blood shooting out everywhere, and he never says nothing. They take his feet, and they push his legs up a little bit and cross them, and then they take that nail and they drive that thing in with that hammer, and you standing there and the blood just squirting around, and the Lord opens not his mouth. He's led like a lamb to the slaughter, and he never says nothing. He willingly goes, and he prayed in the garden. His sweat became as great drops of blood, and he said, "Father, if it be any other way, let this cup pass from me. Not my will, but thine be done." Don't y'all see? He's doing that for you. If there was any other way to save people in this building, God would have done it. But there is no other way. Your sins had to be paid for. Your sins, your rebellion, your offenses toward the Lord had to be paid for. And there he is. And they pull them ropes, and up comes that cross. And when they did, I didn't hear it fall. Into the hole. And there around the cross is men making fun of him. "If thou be the Son of God, come down." He saved others, yet he cannot save himself. He said, "I thirst." And they go, and they went, and they put a sponge and put it in vinegar and then hyssop, and they stuck it on reed and they stuck it up there, and he turned his head and he cries out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And that was just the beginning. And he finally steps out in faith and said, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And he gave up the ghost and died. He died for you. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. The payment of sin is death. Your sins, every one of them, had to be paid for. And on that cross, that's where you deserve to be. You deserve the pain. You deserve whatever Christ bore for you. And then Christ goes down and he suffers until God delivers him. Isn't that something? And then somebody will stick out their chicken breast and say, I think there's a better way. I think you can get saved by being good. Or they'll say, I've heard them to say, well, there's more to it than that. I believe you got to live it. If you don't live it, you ain't got it. How can you live it? How can your life affect what went on in AD 33? How can what you do in this life, or where you come from, or what you did while you were there, in your past, present, or future, how can that have an effect on what Jesus Christ suffered for you? It's not about you, don't you understand? It's about what God's Son did for you, and He paid for your sins. And if you go to hell from here, you're going over the blood of Christ, over the whole gospel of Christ, and if you go to hell, it's your own fault. It's because of unbelief. It ain't got nothing to do with whether or not you was good enough. What are you going to offer to a holy and righteous God anyway? He's holy, he's righteous, he cannot look at sin, he cannot be a part of it, he will not tolerate it. Now, what are you going to give him? Well, Lord, I really tried. Tried? Well, Lord, you know I did the best I could. The best you could? What is the best you could do? The best you could do is trust what he did for you. Now, you know something? I'm not saved because I preach. I'm not saved because I study God's Word. I'm not saved because I read the Bible, believe the Bible. I believe it means what it says, as it says it, where it says it. I'm not saved because that. I'm not saved because I'm a good, nice fella. Because really and truly, I'm not a very nice fella. I'm an old sinner. There are times when you wouldn't want to be around me. I get grumpy sometimes. June says most of the time. I'm sometimes moody. Not often, but sometimes. There are times when I don't feel good. There are days when I hurt more than others. And I'm a grouch. I'm a groove. I mean, I don't want to be bothered some days. I'm not a good, nice fella. I'm not saved because of my goodness. If it's left up to me, I don't have no hope. I'm going to hell. You understand? But it is not left up to me, thank God. Why? Because it's dependent on Him. I'm saved by His faith. Not mine. I just believe. That's good news. I believe that when he died in AD 33, he died for me. And I believe that when they buried him and put him in that tomb, out of the sight of everybody, I was buried with him. My old man went into that grave. And when I came up with Christ, when he came up the third day, the new man came up with him. And I am right now seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I have been justified. and I have been glorified in God's eyes. It's a done deal, and I'm already out there as far as God is concerned. What a Savior. The truth of the gospel is, your sins have been paid for. The truth of the gospel is, it's by the grace of God. Look back in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. He says there in verse 5, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you're saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Bless your soul, I'm the workmanship of the Lord Jesus Christ. He does all the work. Look over there in Philippians. In Philippians chapter 1. In Philippians chapter 1 verse 6. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. He which hath begun a good work in you. Well, where did it start? It started with your salvation. He done a work in you. He's got a purpose for you. And he's going to fulfill that purpose unto the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the day of his glory. Folks, I want to tell you something. I'm going to heaven whether I want to or not. And I couldn't go to hell if I wanted to. And people look at you funny when you say you make a comment like that. That's true. Look in Thessalonians. Just turn to the right. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. The Bible says there in verse 23. 5:23. He said, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body. Now watch it. Be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now watch what verse 24. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. What? Sanctify you. Well, I'm sanctified in the body of Christ. Look in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, notice what it says in verse 3. The Bible says, but the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. Do you know what that establish is? It's to make secure, fix, strengthen. The Lord is faithful, who shall establish you. Not yourself, it's the Lord. Look over in 2 Timothy chapter 2. In 2 Timothy chapter 2. Notice what he says in 2 Timothy chapter 2. And notice this thing. Now I want to tell you something. Let's just read verse 13. In 2 Timothy 2:13, he said, if we believe not, if somewhere in your lifetime you quit believing, he said, if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. He must stay faithful to his word. He must stay faithful to his purpose. He must stay faithful, or he's not God. Folks, God, if God be for you, who can be against you? Paul said, I am persuaded. Look back in chapter 2:1 of 2 Timothy in verse 12. He said, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed. Well, what did he believe? He believed in the Lord. He believed what the Lord told him. Do you realize the Lord is helping you today? The Lord tells you that he's given you eternal life. The Lord told you he would establish you. The Lord told you that he's faithful to keep you. The Lord told you that he will perform that work and he'll keep performing it. He'll get you home. Thank God I don't know the way. I had a man say, well, how are you going to know which way to go? See, he is one of them fellows that believe that your spirit just floated around somewhere and haunt people and all that. He knows the way. It's up to him. He's God. Nothing ever slips up on him. Nothing ever takes him by surprise. Nothing ever changes. I mean, God knows the beginning and the end. And he says there, I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Folks, Paul believed the gospel that was preached to him by the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's the same gospel that I preach to you today. And what you do, well, I'm going to commit my eternal life into his hands. I'm going to, Lord, here I am. Just like Jesus said to the Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Into my hand, your hands, Lord, what's going to happen? I commit it unto thee. And the Lord is faithful. He'll never hurt you. Look back in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Notice what he says there. So, folks, we serve a faithful God. That's the truth of the gospel. It's his grace. Look what he says there in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The Bible said in verse 8. Who, to reference to Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, it didn't say you got to confirm yourself. He's going to confirm you. Notice also, turn to in 2 Corinthians. Second Corinthians, and notice in chapter, he's talking about in chapter 1. I'm just going to just go right in there, but anyway, notice what he says here. Verse 3, blessed be the God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies. And the God of all comfort. Oh, I love that verse, don't you? You see, folks, God cares about you. As a member of his body. And you know, my foot throbs. But I'm not going to cut it off because it's giving me a bad day. I care about it. The smallest member of my body, I care about. Would the Lord not do the same? And he cares. But he says in verse 4, who comforteth us in all our tribulation. Why does he do that? That we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble. By the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also aboundeth by Christ. And old Paul went through it. You know, sometimes God lets people go through things so that they can help other people that's in the body. Sometimes things happen to us and we wonder why, Lord. Down the road we see why. God is faithful. The truth of the gospel is He'll give you eternal life. It's by His grace. He's forgiven you all sins. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Let's stand. You know, it's always fascinating to me that sometimes people, we trust the Lord to save us and we put our eternal destiny into His hands, but we can't trust Him in our everyday walk of life to do right. And that's what you got to do. He's faithful. He's going to do what He said He'd do. He's given you great promises. Just believe Him. Father, we thank You for Thy Word. Thank You for us here. We pray that You'll just, there's one here that's lost. We pray that You'll save them. Dear God, I pray that they saw that there's nothing they can do, that You done it all for them. And may they believe it. Father, I pray for the body of Christ. I pray that they'd be edified. I hope and pray that they was lifted up. And Lord, I pray that You'd give them strength. And Lord, may their faith grow. And they'd have more faith just to rely upon You. Without faith, it's impossible to please You. Then, Father, we pray that Thy will would be done. Be with those that's not here. Be with those that are sick. We pray for their healing. Lord, we just pray that You'd give them grace and strength. Everything is accomplished, we'll give You the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shake hands with one another and you can go.